सभी को नमस्कार, गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। यू ऑल आर वेटिंग ईगरली टू नो मोर अबाउट एग्रीकल्चर, एग्रीकल्चर इन जनरल एंड ऑल्सो एग्रीकल्चर इन इंडिया इन पर्टिकुलर। ऑफकोर्स एज वी ऑल नो दैट दिस इज वन ऑफ द टॉपिक which is kept for national level camp of Vidyarthi Vidyan Manthan. And I am pretty sure that you all are well prepared to take that national level camp with great enthusiasm. But of course, we feel that as you prepare, let's also give some more information to you so you will be able to really take home the necessary and very authentic material. Otherwise, what happens is that when we search, especially on net, with all the authentic things, there are so many other viral things which we come across. And then it can misguide us. So we are making an attempt to make you aware of the authentic material. For senior group in Vidyarthi Vidyan Manthan, it is agriculture and atomic energy. We have a lecture scheduled at 4 p.m. today on atomic energy. Right now, it's about agriculture. What really is important for a survivor, if that question is asked, then definitely people will give different answers. They will say oxygen is necessary, sunlight is necessary, so on and so forth. But of course, one thing remains. For any living being to survive, energy is must. There are different ways in which living being can procure energy. It can be photosynthesis, it can be chemosynthesis, as we all know. But of course, when it comes to what we say as heterotrophs, those who survive not by autotrophic nutrition but heterotrophic nutrition, they have to survive on food material, and we are one of them. The food material which we get from different sources. But of course, what has made our life much more easier is not all cars and homes and things like that in the beginning. It is agriculture, because it ensured that every afternoon, every morning, every evening, every night, we will have food stored for us, and we will be able to get that particular food at the required time. Otherwise, we will have to hunt for the food, get it, and as we all have done that once upon a time when the human race was nomadic. But agriculture has brought a great revolution in the whole scenario. Of course, agriculture has also undergone a lot of evolution. It kept on evolving. Newer and newer things came. And to know more about it, we felt that students should study, students should explore about agriculture. And that is why this is one of the topics kept in your examination at national level camp. And it is also one of the topics for your personal interview. Of course, the topics are a little bit different for your MCQ exam and personal interview. But nevertheless, it's agriculture anyways. Then we also felt that there are so many different things which we keep coming across in different literature. Some of that, if we can highlight, then it will be definitely beneficial to you. Not only from the examination point of view. Exam is just one aspect of the whole thing. But to know more about the recent things which are going on in agriculture, we felt that there should be some experts talking to you. We have two experts today. One is Dr. Kalyan Rao Patil, and the other is Dr. Vinay Kumar.
Vinay Kumar.
Both are experts in agricultural education with tremendous knowledge and lot of research work. Now
please remember that
many farmers do farming, but of course they need to be guided properly. And for this guidance, we need agricultural education. For this agricultural education, there should be more exploration, more risk, and that is exactly these two experts are doing. They are going to talk about different topics. It's going to be something like this. In the beginning, it's going to be Dr. Kalyan Rao Patil, who will be talking more about the genetically modified crops and related things. It's about 30 minutes presentation which he has. Thereafter, Dr. Vinay Kumar will speak on contract farming and more recent issues. Again, 30 more minutes. What I will do is something like this. I will introduce Dr. Kalyan Rao Patil first, then we will listen to him. Then I will introduce Dr. Vinay Kumar, then we will gather knowledge from him, and thereafter we will have time for the question and answer session. Why I am doing so? There is a reason. So you can have uninterrupted presentation from both of them. You will be able to note down the necessary points, make your questions properly, and thereafter you can be very precise in your questioning. Because please remember that everybody's time is important, and yours definitely is, because you're a student. That is why let's keep it very precise. I believe that you definitely will ask very, very pinpointed questions. Some sample questions, not all of them, we will be able to take at the end of the whole session. And please remember, we are going YouTube live, so definitely there has to be quality, which we will have to always keep maintaining. So I'll do one thing. I will invite Dr. Vinay Kumar Patil. Oh, sorry, Dr. Kalyan Rao Patil. I will introduce him briefly. Of course, his CV runs very long. Dr. Kalyan Rao Patil is from Karnataka. His education is from, of course, different colleges in Karnataka, but basically from Dharwad. He finished his BS in agriculture, then MS in technology from G.B. Pant University of Agriculture and Technology in Uttarakhand. His PhD is in seed science and technology from Indian Agricultural Research Institute, New Delhi, very prestigious institute. He received ICAR-JRF, that is Junior Research Fellow, and SRF, that is Senior Research Fellow, for his master and doctoral program. He joined Anand University as assistant professor in 2012. He is teaching the courses of seed technology for undergraduate students and discipline seed science and technology. He was elected as executive counselor of Indian Society for Seed Technology, New Delhi, for two terms. Presently, he is working as Head Department of Seed Science and Technology, Agricultural University at Anand, Gujarat. Of course, he has many laurels to his credit. many awards. He has ICAR sponsored University Best Teacher Award from ex-governor of Gujarat. Then Varadbhai Ambadas Patel Best Teacher Award in BACA Alumni Association at Anand. Emerging Leader in Agriculture Science at Venue International Foundation, Chennai. Young Science Award, Society for Biotic and Environmental Research, Tripura. It's very brief in what I have tried to introduce it. But we all are, and so I am eager to listen to him, listen to his presentation with great depth, and also note down the necessary points which you can definitely carry for your further work, and also find out which questions you can ask. And please remember, you will not ask questions which are related to only syllabus. The syllabus is one part of it, as I said, but there can be more exploration as well. And please don't ask those questions which are extremely basic, for which everybody has gathered necessary knowledge. So let's make great use of both these dignitaries. Thank you. And definitely, I feel that this is going to be extremely interactive session. Over to you, Dr. Patil.
Hello. Hello, sir. Okay.
Sir, you can start.
Okay. Thank you, sir, for introducing me. Today's topic is agriculture in our country. First of all, good morning to all students and VVM Dr. Vijay sir and Dr. Rajkumar sir. As per the discussion with Dr. Vijay sir, first 15 minutes I am going to take with respect to the history of agriculture in India, and later 15-20 minutes I will take with respect to the genetically modified crops. Yeah, with respect to the history of agriculture, as today's the most intelligent man on the earth, that is Homo sapiens, he was evolved from the Homo erectus near about 2 lakhs years ago. And when he started moving from one place to one other place, and he particularly for food, he started as a hunter and gatherer for particularly for food. As the day advances, the process of domestication was started near about 10,000 years ago. And particularly the cultivation of the crops were started near about 8th to 7th millennium BC. Particularly, he started, the Homo sapiens has started the cultivation of the most important wheat, then to the amber wheat and einkorn wheat. And later he started domestication of the other food crop, barley, pea, lentil, etc. As the days moves, he started domesticating more and more food crops, particularly in the civilization era, particularly in case of our Indus civilization, Roman civilization, or Egyptian civilization, as you studied in your 7th-8th class. All these civilizations were started on the river bank. As Indus River is the main river for the civilization of the Indians. And he started from moving one place to another places to, he started settling at a particular place on the bank of the river. And with respect to the agriculture history, particularly in Indian subcontinent, the same, the 9500 BC, the evidence was recorded particularly for the domestication of the wheat crops. And later the Indian in menu, particularly the rice, is used as a Indian food near about 8000 BC. And the irrigation system, particularly I already told that they have started settling on the river bank. Because of that reason, they have started using that water for the irrigation, particularly in the agriculture production or food production. In this way, they have started irrigation development work also. And the plowing, particularly the cultivation purpose, the plowing of the land was started near about 2500 BC. And in the era of the rulers, particularly the Mughal rulers, they have also contributed a lot for this agriculture, the mulberry cultivation and as well as sericulture, particularly for the silk production, this was the contribution from the Mughal period. And what the commercialization of agriculture, particularly in the colonial era, Britishers, the second half of the Britisher era, that is 1850 to 1947, the commercialization of agriculture was started. Commercialization means all the particular, for example, you take the example of the cotton. The cotton is used for the textile industry, means the textile industries were started, sugarcane industries were started. Means from this colonial rules, Britishers rules onwards, the Indian agriculture becomes a commercialization agriculture. Means the agriculture has taken as a business oriented. But the most significant event in the Indian history, that is 1960s, the Green Revolution after independence, this was the golden era or golden period for Indian agriculture. Now I am coming to the what Indian agriculture and particularly with respect to India. You all might knowing that India is the seventh largest country in the globe, and it is contributing near about 17 to 18% of the world population as on date, and near about 15% of the world cattle population. But when it comes to the area wise, we are only 2.4% of the global land area, and water is only 4.2%. Means from such a small land holdings or such a small land, we are feeding near about 18% of the global population. And when compared to the per capita availability of the resources, 4 to 6% lesser resources we have in India compared to the global average. This is the most important slide I want to discuss with you. That is ship to mouth. Most of the this 12th standard or high school student might not knowing that the ship to mouth. This is the very important. After independence, what happened during the first 15 to 20 years, there was a food shortage in the country. That time, we are always waiting for the ship to come Indian port. Then only we can feed our particularly the citizens of the country. That was the situation. Means that India is going in front of the globe with a begging bowl for food. That was the situation in 1950s. Even in the 1960s also, the most honest prime minister of the country, Lal Bahadur Shastri, all of you know, he gave this slogan, that is Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan, from the historic Red Fort. That was the most significant slogan in the Indian history. Why? Means that was the decade. During that time, there was a war in the country as well as there was a food shortage. Because of that reason, he told, this India can be saved only by two persons. One is Jawan and another one is the Kisan. Because of his foresightedness, later the Green Revolution was came in India in 1966 under the leadership of Indira Gandhi and also from the scientist side. Means both political support as well as from the support of the, because of the work of the scientist, we have achieved the Green Revolution. Means whatever the stigma was there with respect to the India, that is the begging bowl and ship to mouth, that stigma was removed because of this Green Revolution, which was achieved in 1966. And today, we are not only food sufficient for our own people, but we also started exporting to the other country. And in UPA government, particularly in 2010 to 13, they have formulated Food Security Act. Means now all the citizens should be provided with wheat and rice at a minimum price for the citizen of the country. That was the Food Security Act was. Means from a shortage to we are now circus. Even from the last 1.5 year, this is the situation in the country, that is because of the global pandemic of this coronavirus, we have started feeding entire population because we have with a buffer stock in the country. Even under such situation also, we are feeding all the people. Means we have achieved very lot in agriculture, particularly for food productions. And this is the these are the two important stalwarts for all the students. This is very important. One side, the father of Green Revolution of the globe. Another side, the father of Green Revolution in India, Norman E. Borlaug. He is the only agriculture scientist in the globe who got Nobel Prize. The unfortunate for agriculture scientists is we don't have a separate agriculture Nobel Prize. But the man Norman E. Borlaug, he got Nobel Prize because in the field of the peace, by giving food to the citizen of the globe, he made peace in the entire globe. That's why he got Nobel Prize in 1970. and the Swaminathan, M.S. Swaminathan, Managampu Sambasimam Swaminathan. He was the father of Indian Green Revolution. Why Indian Green Revolution was occurred? Because of the two genes. That is, one is the DZ Wu gen from Taiwan variety rice, that is TN1, that is Taichung native one, and in case of wheat, Norin10, that is dwarfing gene from the Daruma wheat. Because of these two genes, we have developed dwarfing varieties in India, and the same genes were used for other Indian cultivated species. By this way, we can achieve the Green Revolution. And later, because of this other program, my friend or colleague, he is from Extension, he will tell you, that is High Yielding Variety Program in 1966. Because of that program, we have distributed seeds to almost all part of the country. Because of this reason, we have achieved Green Revolution. And we also thankful to these two stalwart of the globe. And this was the situation, what the food grain production during 1950-51 was only 50 million tons. And today we have near about 300 million tons production. And simultaneously you look on parallel, that time in 1950, the global population, particularly Indian population, was near about 37 crore. Means the total food grain production was 50 million tons and population was 37 crore. But today the population of the country is near about 137 to 40 crores and food grain production was near about 300. Means how many times the population is increased, how many times the food grain production was increased. The food grain production was increased near about 6 times. And contrary to the population was increased only near about 4 times. Means by reducing the land of the country every year because of the construction, infrastructure work, or by building, increasing population, we are reducing. Our land is declining year by year, but we are increasing production of agriculture day by day because of this agriculture scientist. The same was procedure in almost all the crops. You can take the pulse, oilseed, cotton. There is an entire boom in the India that is cotton. That is because of that time, that region, BT cotton particularly, the 11 times higher productivity, 11 times we have achieved the production. This was because of the BT cotton. I will discuss BT cotton later. And these were the revolutions in India. One is Green Revolution, as I already told, under the leadership of M.S. Swaminathan, we have achieved the Green Revolution. Here in case of photograph, the first photograph, the M.S. Swaminathan and Norman Borlaug, and White Revolution, the place where I belong, are now I am working, that is the Anand. Anand is known as the milk capital of the country. In second photo, you can see the Amul baby along with Varghese Kurian. He is known as a father of White Revolution in the globe. Because of his foresightedness, we have achieved the White Revolution, and India is the largest milk producer in globe. And similar way, Yellow Revolution with respect to oilseed, because of Rajiv Gandhi's foresightedness, he started the oilseed technology missions in 1980s. Because of that reason, we have achieved. Same thing, Blue Revolution, Golden Revolution, this is with respect to fruit and vegetable crops. We have achieved a lot under the leadership of K.L. Chadha. These are the some of the great achievement of the Indian agriculture from last 60 to 70 years. I want to just discuss with about ICR and agriculture system in India. ICR, Indian Council of Agriculture Research, it was established in 16th July 1929 by the Imperial Government, means the British government. That's why that time it was called as the Imperial Council of Agriculture Research. And this is a society. This society is registered to Society Registration Act in 1860. In today's pandemic, every day you are hearing the ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research. On same pattern, this is the Indian Council of Agriculture Research. This is the, I can say, the headquarter of this ICR is located at New Delhi. And these are the mandate of the ICAR. One is the main, whenever you go to the agriculture sector, there will be three pillars of the agriculture. One is research, extension, and education. These are the three pillars of the agriculture. On same pattern, the ICAR is having a 4 mandate. First one is to coordinate the research activity of the entire country. Second one is to coordinate the agriculture education for the development of the human resources. And last one is frontline extension technology. And along with these three, this has to always cope up, or it can also give some information, whatever the basic information required for formulating the bills, act, policies for the parliament as well as the state government. These are the 4 important mandate of the ICAR. And this is the ICR is in India having a wild network, wide network. First, we have four deemed universities. First one is IAR, Indian Agriculture Research Institute. It is located at New Delhi. And IVRI, Indian Veterinary Research Institute. It is located at Izzatnagar. Next one is NDRI, National Dairy Development Research Institute at Karnal. Last one is CPSIF, that is Fishery Institute, that is located at Mumbai. These are the four deemed universities. And we have 64 ICR national institute. They are spread across the different states. Means almost all states have one or the other national institutes and 15 national research centers and 6 national bureaus. As an agriculturist, for me, the NDPHR is very important. National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources for Animal Science, that is National Bureau of Animal Science. Like that, there are, we have 6 national bureaus and 13 directorates and 700 KVKs. This is very important because Mohan Singh Mehta Committee in 1970s, particularly 74, he recommended the farmer service center, particularly for giving the service to the farmers. On that concept, the Krishi Vijnana Kendra was established. As on date, almost all the district of the country, they have one or the other KVKs. Means in some of the big district, we have 2 KVKs also. The presently in India, we have more than 700 KVKs operating. And with respect to the history of IRA, this is the premier institutes. This was institute was established in 1905 at Pusa in Bihar, Samastipur district. The initial it was established at Samastipur district. Why the name Pusa came? Means the person who donated fund for the establishment of this in agriculture institute India is from USA, Phillips from USA. Because of that reason, the name came Pusa. But after 30 years, near about 30 years, there was a natural calamities occur in the Pusa campus. Because of that reason, there was a severe earthquake. And this institute was shifted from IRI Pusa Samastipur to IRI New Delhi. Why? Because that, by that time, the capital city of the British Empire was shifted from Calcutta to New Delhi. And their aim was most prestigious institute should be there in the capital. That's why they have shifted this institute from Samastipur district to Pusa, New Delhi. Nowadays also, if you go in Delhi, you can ask anyone Pusa, they will tell this is the location. But none of other people, they know with IARI name. So Pusa is the unique name of this institute. And one more significant year is 1958. Why 1958? Means in India, the first university, not only agriculture, I am telling, in entire traditional universities also, the first university, it got a deemed university state in the country, along with the Indian Institute of Science. Means these are the two institutes. One is the Indian Institute of Science, Bengaluru, and this Pusa campus, they have got a deemed university status on 12th May 1958. And one more important history with respect to establishment of the state agriculture university. After the independence, there were no any agriculture university in the country. Because of that reason, the Nehru government appointed a one committee under the leadership of S. Radhakrishnan for the establishment of the rural agriculture university. Based on his recommendation, the first agriculture university was established on 17th November 1960 at Pantnagar. Earlier, it was a part of Uttar Pradesh. That's why the initial name of this university is Uttar Pradesh Agriculture University Act. Later, its name is changed into G.B. Pant University of Agriculture and Technology on the remembrance of the freedom fighter Bharat Ratna Pandit Govind Ballabh Pant. And I can say for all the students' information, this is the Asia's largest university with respect to area. Asia's largest, and when it comes to the globe, it is the second largest university with respect to area. It is having near about 20 kilometer length and 14 kilometer width. Such a big university, it was established on the concept of the US, that is land grant pattern. Land means the grant will be provided from the land. That was the concept of the state agriculture university. And later, other two universities were established on the same concept. That is one PAU, Punjab Agriculture University, Ludhiana, and Chaudhary Charan Singh, Haryana Agriculture University, Hisar. This is also one of the important slide because the scientist who got World Food Prize. As I already told, there is no Nobel Prize for the agriculture scientist, but with the support of Norman E. Borlaug, after getting the world of this Nobel Prize, he initiated under one foundation, that is World Food Prize. This is called as a Nobel Food Prize for agriculture scientists, we believe. This is the great prize These are the scientists, near about 8 scientists from the India. They have got World Food Prize. The first person in the globe who got World Food Prize is M.S. Swaminathan because of introducing the high-yielding rice and wheat varieties. Second, Varghese Kurian, of course, the milk revolution, that is the Operation Flood. And the third one is Gurudev Singh Kus from Punjab. He got World Food Prize for the miracle rice. And Dr. B.R. Baravale, Badri Narayan R. Baravale, he is from Maharashtra. He started the first seed company at Jalna, a small place in Jalna. Now it is, of course, a district. That time it was a very small place in Jalna, Aurangabad district. Now it is a separate district. He started the Myco seed company for the distribution of the seed to the globe. And hence, he is known as the father of Indian seed industry. Because of that, in the entire India, now we have more and more company. Means the private seed company model was developed by Baravale. Surendra K. Vassal, development of the quality. M. Gupta, particularly for the fishery sector. Sanjay Rajaraman, he developed near about 500 varieties, particularly the wheat varieties resistant to pest and disease and high yielding. And he worked entire his research in Mexico. And last year, 2020, Ratan Lal, the soil scientist, he got World Food Prize. But this year, in 2021, World Food Prize is also announced just 2 days back. The award winner is Shakuntala Harak Singh. Most of the people, they are saying she is Indian by name Shakuntala, but she is not Indian, she is West Indies. The same name is their Indian name. Now I am moving from history of agriculture to the allotted topic, that is genetically modified crop. Most of the students, they have studied in 11th and 10th, what is genetically modified crop or GM crop. In India, the synonym word we are using GM to transgenic, but it is not synonym. Because in India, we have only one crop, this BT. BT and GM, they are using synonym. But in India, we have only one GM crop. That's why we are using. Otherwise, the GM and transgenic crops, they are one another synonym. It is a combination of genetic material obtained through the use of modern biotechnology tools or biotechnology engineering. This is also known as a recombinant DNA technology. Whatever that DNA is there, we are recombinating. That's why it is called as recombination DNA. In 1994, the first genetically modified tomato in particularly food crop, and with respect to in all the food crops, 1982 is the first GM crop was released in tobacco. And this GM technology is also known as a precision breeding technology. Why precision breeding means here we can transfer the whatever the gene we require, that genes we can transfer to the cultivated species. But in case of the conventional plant breeding, it is very difficult to transfer the desired gene. Along with the desired gene, there are some other undesirable genes can also be transferred. That was the difficulties. Next one is, this is the source of organisms. Means this, these are the general steps involved in the GM crop production. First one is the whatever the organism, either it may be a crop or it may be a animals or it may be a bacteria. From that bacteria or others, we are transferring these genes from cultivated species. That's why what are the steps involved in the transfer or development of the GM crop. First one is genomic DNA isolation. Whatever the desired gene is there, that one should be isolated. Next one is the amplifying the gene using PCR technology, means polymerase chain technology. We are increasing the number of copies. Next, by using the agrobacterium species, that is a soil bacteria, from that we are agrobacterium, we are transferring to the cultivated species. This is the steps. And what are the benefits of the genetically modified crop? In the globe, as on date, we have number of different traits related GM crops were released, herbicide resistant, insect resistant, or even disease resistant, stress tolerance. Because of this type of the resistance, we are using the less number of the chemical spray. Once we use the less number of the chemical spray, we can reduce the environmental effect. Whatever the environmental hazardous effect is there because of spraying these chemicals, we can reduce. Ultimately, by reducing the chemical, simultaneously, we can decrease our agriculture input cost. Whatever the input cost is there, we can reduce. And the farmers' incomes will also be increased. What our Honorable Prime Minister said, by 2022, we can increase the farmers' yield double. Such things can be done through the GM crops also. Sustainability will be increased the farm profit, also the more nutritious food, because by transferring a specific gene, we can increase more food also, nutritious food. Particularly, you have seen golden rice. We can increase the vitamin A content in that. Or even in some particular crops, we have increased the shelf life. Particularly in case of the tomato, the storage life of the tomato is increased because of this. This is GMO. The GMO foods, what are the different GMO foods used in agriculture? Particularly, one is a tomato, rice, sweet corn, summer squash. These are the different food crops where the GMO foods were used. Next one is genetically modified crop. What is the global status? Already, I think near about 25 years is completed after the release of this genetically modified crops. And as on date, the India is the fifth largest country in the globe. It is having the GM area. First is USA, near about 71 million hectare area and 95% adoption. And Brazil is this 52 million hectare with 94% adoption. And India is having near about 12 million hectare area with 94% adoption. What is this 94 adoption means? Whatever the area for particular cotton crop is there, out of that, the 94% of the cotton is grown only with respect to the BT. 94% area is only BT. Remaining 6% was non-BT. That was the concept. Within a gap of near about 16-17 years, we have covered 94% of the area with BT cotton. And this is the global status with respect to crop. Earlier, with respect to the country, now this is with respect to the crop in the globe. The highest area covered is soybean, particularly that to be herbicide resistant. Near about 91.9 million hectare is with respect to biotech or GM soybean. Second place is with respect to maize, near about 60.9 million hectare. And with respect to cotton, this is about 25.7 million hectares. You see here, with respect to the cotton, near about 12% means the 50% of the global GM cotton is grown in India. Out of 25, 12 million hectare is in India. This is the global status with respect to crop wise. And these are the countries where the GM crops is grown in the globe. The genetically modified crop, particularly in the Asia, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Myanmar, these are the main countries. Otherwise, the maximum this GM technology is used in the New World. New World means the North American continent and South American continent. In figure, in photograph, you see the entire American continent, both North and South American continents, all with color. When comes to the Africa and Asia, it is very less. Means that most of the GM crops were grown in the American continents. These are the major crops, as I already told, in USA. The major crops were grown is maize, soybean, cotton, all these crops. The Brazil, and with respect to India, only the GM crop is cotton in India. That is about 12 million hectare. This is why the modern biotechnology tool is used, or what is the difference between conventional plant breeding, what the regularly we are using in agriculture. You consider one is this red color is A parent, or the green color is B parent. Or you can say already the source variety means this is a GM. The red color is you consider as a GM, and this is our commercial cultivated crop. If we are going by conventional breeding along with our desired this yellow color, along with our desired, there will be some undesirable genes is also transferred. That is called as the linkage trap. You have studied the 50% will become from male and 50% will become from other female. Same thing here, there will be a linkage trap. But when you are going to through modern biotechnology, what is the desired gene is that one we can transfer through recombinant DNA technology. That's why the GM technology is more advantageous when compared to the conventional breeding. But it is not possible in all those cases. There are some difficulties also. These are the certain GM trait-wise. Earlier, we have crop-wise we studied. This is the trait-wise. First one is herbicide-resistant. Herbicide-resistant GM crop means here, whenever the farmers, they are spraying the herbicides, the herbicide will kill only the weeds. It should not give any effect to the cultivated crop. Such technology is more highly used in case of the American continent, that is in case of corn, soybean, rice, and sugar beet. With respect to insect resistance, in India we are using a GM cotton, that is BT cotton, and others are corn, rice, brinjal, okra, and tomato. And viral resistant GM crops virus, particularly the leaf curl virus and poty X and poty Y virus, potato virus, the papaya, squash, and potato. The slow ripening and softening, because nowadays we are facing most of the problem in case of the horticulture crop, that is perishable commodity, particularly fruits and vegetables. How we can control this? Through GM technology, we can extend the shelf life of the fruits and vegetables, that is the slow ripening and softening, improved oil quality in case of canola. Canola means just like a mustard. In India, we will call mustard, but in case of Canada, that is canola. Canola means Canadian oil. That's why the name canola is came. And soybean. Male sterility. This is the very, very important with respect to seed technologies as well as breeding for the hybrid seed production purpose. Whenever we go increase the hybrid seed production, the male sterility is very important. The male sterility technology is also developed in case of the canola, rice, and corn. These are the trait-wise GM crops in India. Now, I am coming to Indian scenario, because in India, we have only GM crop, that is BT. Why the BT is name is came? That is Bacillus thuringiensis. The gene which is derived from this soil bacterium, the gram-positive bacterium, that is Bacillus thuringiensis. And this BT was first time discovered by the Japanese scientist Shibata in 1901. Before introducing this BT genes to the cotton, the same Bacillus thuringiensis were used for the control of the pest under the integrated pest management system. And this was used as a pesticide in France, Germany, so many countries. And by knowing that, they have transferred the specific gene to the cultivated cotton species. The BT gene, that is Cry1AC. Cry1AC means crystalline 1AC genes, which is used for the development of the BT cotton variety. The gene was transferred into the genome of the cottons through vector, that is Agrobacterium tumefaciens. This TI vector is used for the transformation purpose. This is by that time. So many people were asked, why the BT cotton? The thing, certain things are there. BT cotton crop is a long duration crop. When compared to you go for the green gram, black gram, you can get the crop yield within 2 to 3 months. But in case of the cotton, it takes longer time. Cotton and even pigeon pea, these crops takes longer time. Because of when you are exposing your crop for longer time, there is a chance of more number of pests and diseases. And the cotton is such a unique crop. It is affected by so many number of the bollworms, that is Helicorpa, Armigera, American bollworm, Pectinophora, Gossypiella, Irias, Vitella, Irias insulana. These are the different pests which are attacking on the cotton bolls. And the third thing is, before 2002, the Indian farmers, they are spraying large quantity of this pesticide to the cotton, to the tune of 747 crores only for the control of the bollworm. In India, you see the situation, how much quantity of the spray we are using for controlling these three pests. That is only for bollworm. Because of that, and one more interesting thing is, most of these cotton bolls, they are hidden insect. Hidden insect means, if you look the bollworm, it will look very healthy, but insect will be there inside. But you can increase any number of spray, but it will not affect the insect, because the insects are totally seated in the AC room. And wo sab jaake andar baith gaye, isliye wo chemical ko expose nahi ho raha. Because of that reason, it was very difficult to control the hidden pest. Next one is bollworm, especially pink and spotted bollworm are hidden feeder. And this, because of these many important reasons, the government have come up with this BT cotton. And one other thing is, if the farmers, they are spraying same chemical under a different interval, some of the insect may get resistance. These are the some of the important reasons why we go with this BT cottons. And where this basic research, particularly from 1990 to 2002, in India, the research were conducted at National Botanical Research Institute, Lucknow, NRCPB. This is an ICR institute. It is located at New Delhi. The mainly work is with respect to biotechnology. Another one is the International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology. This is an international institute. It is headquarters is located at Italy, but the another regional branch is located at Pusa campus in India. This is the most just fourth number, that is Central Institute of Cotton Research. This is the pillar institute of ICR for research purpose. All the students should know, whenever the cotton comes, you always remember this institute, Central Institute of Cotton Research, Nagpur. And along with that, the National Chemical Laboratory of Pune, this is a part of the CSIR institutes, BARC, Bhabha Atomic Research Institute, and last, only State Agriculture University, which is involved in the development of the BT or GM cotton, is University of Agriculture Sciences, Dharwad. This is some legal aspect I am telling. Before conducting this research, what are the phases? This is important. One is, whenever any university or any institute, if they want to go, then particular one thing is laboratory level phases is required. Second one is the breeding phase. Next one is biosafety aspect. Last one is the regulatory process. These are the three, four processes that I will come with respect to this four committees. Where one is IBS, institution, this is institutional biosemitic committee. Means all the institutes should have their own committee before conducting the GM research. The first they have to take approval from that committee. Then only they can go for the research, laboratory level research, and maximum extent they can go up to the greenhouse. Next is a review committee for genetic manipulation. This is a part of Department of Biotechnology and Ministry of Science and Technology. It is comes. This institute, this committee will give permission or approve or not to approve the conduct of small scale trial and for the generation of the information of the transgenic organism. Means we are called as small scale varietal trials, large scale varietal trial at institute level. But the most important committee, GEAC, Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee, this is the most important committee. This will give for the commercial cultivation. As on date in India, only the cotton is given for permission. And these are the some of the varieties or technologies developed by the different private company, Monsanto, Monsanto, JK Seeds, even Metahelix. These are the some companies they have developed. And this is the other crops where the GM is developed by India, but it is not got commercial cultivation. One is insect resistant BT brinjal. Another one is GM mustard. GM mustard particularly for the male sterility purpose, and insect resistant BT brinjal particularly for soot and fruit borer. And this is my last slide. This is a very explaining slide, self-explaining slide, because the first Prime Minister of the country, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, said everything else can wait but not agriculture. Sab kuch ruk sakta hai, magar agriculture nahi ruk sakta. In the present situation, from last 1.5 year, what we are observing, the global pandemic in the country, under such situation, we have stopped rail, airport, we have stopped all the industries, everything we under lockdown. But only sector that is open is agriculture. Without agriculture, no one will get. That's why 50, 60 years back, only the Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru told, everything else can wait, but not agriculture. You see, this is the status of the last time GDP. All the sectors were in the negative side. Only sector which is positive side is agriculture. This is my last slide. In India, so many people say the culture, Hindu culture, Muslim culture like that. But for India, only culture is that is agriculture. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And you said was absolutely right. सब कुछ रुक सकता है लेकिन एग्रीकल्चर नहीं, क्योंकि वही अपना एनर्जी सोर्स है. थैंक यू डॉक्टर पाटिल. एंड आई विल नॉट टेक मच ऑफ योर टाइम राइट नाउ बिकॉज वी हैव वन मोर एक्सपर्ट वेटिंग एंड देयर आफ्टर देयर आर गोइंग टू बी क्वेश्चंस एंड आंसर्स. आई विल इंट्रोड्यूस द नेक्स्ट स्पीकर. द नेक्स्ट स्पीकर इज Yes, Dr. Vinay Kumar, Assistant Professor of Agriculture Extension and Communication at Anand Agricultural University. He is a doctorate, his PhD from University of Agricultural Sciences, Bangalore. Academic achievements are plenty. I will briefly go through some of them. a young extension scientist award from Society of Extension Education Gujarat in 2019, awarded 5 best paper award in national and international seminar, awarded Shri Varadbhai Ambadas Patel Best Undergraduate Teacher Award, Anand, awarded for University of Agricultural Science Gold Medal from US, Bengaluru, then awarded a centrally administered doctoral fellowship from the Indian Council of Social Sciences for the PhD, awarded Best Young Scientist in UGC-sponsored state-level conference 2014, awarded a PERS fellowship for doctoral degree from DBT, awarded Best Outgoing Student from University of Agricultural Sciences, Bengaluru, and he has teaching experience of 5 years, advising he's also in the advisory board, and he keeps giving such lectures to enlighten young mind. His field of interest is climate change, corporate institutions, food and nutrition security, sustainable development. So I request Dr. Vinay Kumar to please start his discussion, and thereafter we will take the questions. So students, please keep posting your questions on the group. Over to you, Dr.
Sir, thank you so much, sir. My screen is visible. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for the opportunity. And,
sir, it is visible. And, we can see.
Yeah. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. And thank you so much for the opportunity, and very good morning to all the students out there live in the YouTube. And also special thanks to the VVM ICS senior group for providing this opportunity. And you had my introduction. Myself, I'm Dr. Vinay, working as an assistant professor in Anand Agriculture University. And so focus with respect to that, the flow of presentation and all, I will directly hit on to the topic. As some of my content has already, covered by my colleague, Dr. Kalyan Ravji, and I appreciate that. As with respect to that, we all knew that world population, we are in second position, and by 2030, we'll go into surpass China. That is a prediction, and we don't know exactly what will going to happen, but what is the growing trend right now? We will definitely going to surpass China and will be the number one with respect to the world population. And well, compared to the China's and Indian population, we are put together, we are around one third of the world's population. As I know, Kalyanji was mentioning with respect to the land resources, we have very limited land resources, and also with respect to the water resources. With this scarcity of resources, feeding such a large population is quite challenging. If you go back to some of the statistics with respect to the total geographical area and net zone area and grass zone areas, with respect to that, and majority of the land with respect to barren land and degraded land and also the forest land, it is not available for the agriculture purpose. And also with respect to the, if you look back to the net zone area to the irrigated area, we are around 64.7 million hectares of irrigated land. That is, around 55% of the land under the rain-fed agriculture. That means we are still depending on agriculture. That means there in majority of that areas, the monocropping will be there. Means only single crop in a year can be grown. By all these difficulties, if you also look at something related to the cropping intensity, we have hardly around 136 million hectares, the cropping intensity. What I mean to quote here, so such a, limited resources with respect to that net cultivated area to the cropping intensity. So we are feeding greatest population, largest population in the world. And Kalyanji was mentioning with respect to the food, insecure or maybe the food shortage shift to mouth, classes to the, now we are with respect to the surplus country. And I quote here, with respect to the production, we may be good enough, but with respect to the productivity, we still lag behind because of the technological issues. As he was mentioning with respect to that BT Brinja, BT other cottons, other varieties, in India, we are not allowed to release, but in other countries, these people are growing, and we are just exporting those commodities and we are using in India. with the different kinds of processed product and all. So, but we are not allowed to grow in our own country, and these are the things are there with respect to our agriculture sector still facing a lot of issues. So I would like to quote here before going to the exact topic, how many farmers we have. So as I would like to mention here, in a pre-independence to the right now, the drastical reduce in the population who are depending on agriculture. But I would like to quote here, you can see here, around 85 to 88% of the population, farmers are marginal end farmers, those who are the resource poor farmers. The resource rich farmers, you could able to make only 5% of the farmers. If I quote an example here, in the independence period, we have around 70% of the population are depending on agriculture. The recent NSSO report says that at the present, we have around 48% of the population are depending on agriculture. So it might be drastically reduced with respect to the involvement in agriculture for a livelihood. But I quote here, around 50% of the population still depending on agriculture to feed the entire population. That means efficiency is still a questionable. That means in America, if you quote, only 3% of the population is doing agriculture and feeding the entire nation and also exporting a lot of commodity to the other countries. Here, to feed 10 people, 5 people has to work. See, that means with respect to the efficiency in agriculture sector is again questionable. And also with respect to the, as he was mentioned, in the pandemic, agriculture could able to have the positive growth. So that shows here 19.9% of the contribution to the national GDP in 2021. When it was in 19 and 20, it was just 17.8%. That means in the pandemic also, we could able to perform well in agriculture sector. As a result of this agriculture growth is a phenomenal. With respect to that, in he was mentioned in one of his slides, in the 1950s, we had 1950-51, the food grain production was just a 50 million tons. And in 2021, the estimated, I would like to quote here, 303 million tons. That means 6 times increase is there. So agriculture is doing with respect to that production aspect. But I always quote with respect to the technology adoption, but with respect to the efficiency and also the productivity, again, we have to look at and our government and also with respect to our farmers has to improve a lot. So recently, there are a number of issues you could able to see here because the farmers strike, farmers are going against the recent 3 farmers law. Why they are going? I'm not discussing all much in detail, but I would like to quote one of the important laws. That is a Farmers Empowerment and Protection Agreement of Price and Farm Services. This is much related to your contract farming. So I would like to focus here why farmers are going against that and what are the issues. If you have any queries related to that, we can discuss in other session or maybe you can write me an email. But majority of the cases, there is a misleading of information. And if you look back to this something related to the contract farming, the way this was first introduced, so it was introduced in Taiwan in the year 1895 by Japanese government. The European first introduced indigo and opium cultivation in the West, in the Bengal region under the East India Company. And ICT also introduced during the year 1920 for growing the Virginia tobacco in Andhra Pradesh. And PepsiCo, they have come up into the contract farming, particularly in the tomato and potato in Punjab in the year 1927. And when you go with something like Green Revolution period or maybe the seed company's emergence and also the PepsiCo's involvement in the contract farming, they are the major milestones in emergence of contract farming in India. So particularly in Karnataka, as I belongs to Karnataka, I would like to mention that in Karnataka, it was introduced through the Garkin in 20th century. So by all these questions, explanations, you might be having doubt with respect to that. What do you mean by contract farming? I would like to give a simple definition. Before that, I also want to make you clear with respect to that, how to understand any concept. Try to split the words like contract and farming. The farming is might be you can understand with respect to the cultivating the crops or maybe the cultivating the soil. In a simple understanding, I mean to make. What do you mean by contract? The contract means agreement. Here you are making an agreement with the farmers. That means here agreement between the farmers and processing or maybe the marketing firms for what? For the production and supply of agriculture products under certain agreement with respect to some of the rules and regulations, or maybe with respect to that, this much of amount I will go into fix it for the particular product and you have to give this much of quantity to me. So for example, here you can go with some of the factors, what are the elements are involved in the contract farming. For example, here you can go ahead, some of the elements in this definition you could be able to identify. One is predetermined price. The first elements of contract farming is a predetermined price. And second elements you could be able to identify here is the quality of the produce. And then is quantity. And with respect to that, another time and area, how much area you will go into have the contract. And with respect to that, what type of product you will go into, produce. So here the contract farming, another two important aspects you could able to identify. One is farmer and processing, or maybe a company. Farmers and company. What is the farmer role and what is the company's role in the contract farming? The farmer's role is providing the land and labor and cultivating the produce. And company will going to give the technical inputs and other production inputs like seeds, fertilizers, and pesticide and other and required element for the production aspect. And it will going to buy the product from the farmers. So main role with respect to that, providing the technical know-how and also input material to the farmers. And farmer will provide the land and labor and cultivating the crop and supply to the contracted company. So what is the need of contract farming in India? Why we require? One is important factor is that the production and marketing are very critical to the India. You know that farmers are not lagging behind with respect to the production system, but they are not getting the remunerative price. As Kalyanji was mentioning, doubling the farmers in, he mentioned with respect to the doubling the production, but it has to be a doubling the farmers' income. Farmers' income is doubled from the pre-independence to the till now. Obviously, farmers are getting the better income, but I mean to say not in the gross income, but it is with respect to the real income. How to improve the real income? You have to reduce the cost. Otherwise, you have to multiply the production system. That means not in the production aspect, but you have to improve the productivity. So thereby, it will be more important. Okay, the farmer is producing and productivity has improved, but with respect to the question is remunerative price. Whether he's getting the adequate price is again questionable. We have number of crops in India, but only 23 crops are getting the minimum support price. Another demand with respect to the farmer's bill is that they would like to make minimum support as an amendment act, or maybe the act in the government rule. So when it become an act, the government supposed to buy all the produce that is and all the product that is produced by the farmers. So that's what government is denying, that we cannot go as a law. Now it is not a law. When it become a law, that means government has to buy all the product that is produced by the law. Here again, two important things the farmers are scared about. One is if this farmers bill come, so we'll lose the minimum support price. It will not going to happen even in the bill also. And also abolishing the APMC Act. So it is not going to do in that particular aspect also. But still the number of issues that farmers are putting in front of the government to come up with some of the corrections in their laws. And also with respect to that, as I said, with respect to one is a market and another is lack of capital, poor infrastructure and technology transfer. Here I would like to mention I'll take the reference of my previous slide again. So 88% of the farmers are resource poor farmers, small and marginal farmers. So they are having less than 2 acres of land. Who will going to provide the credit facility for them? Again, questionable. If you don't have any kind of security, again, it will be a biggest question mark to the financial institution to provide the credit facilities. As I would like to mention poor infrastructure. So poor infrastructure, how many villages in an urban area, you cannot do the farming as it with respect to that, a terrace gardening and all, they have the new concept, but it is not sufficient to feed the population. So you have to depend on agriculture in the rural area itself. But how many villages have the godowns, cold storage? So again, it is questionable. Now the infrastructure with respect to the electricity or maybe with respect to the road, it's quite accessible and adjustable. But when it comes to the needed resources, infrastructure, facilities at the village, again, it is inadequate. And transfer of technology is Heracles. With respect to, I would like to mention, one extension person is dealing with 800 to 1,000 farmers. If you want to meet once in a year, so he will going to meet the same person after 2 years. That means one person one day, so again, he will going to meet that person after 2 years. So a lot of technological gap and technology transfer is again questionable with respect to the extension personnel and farmers ratio is a huge gap in India. And also to avoid the post-harvest losses. So our chairman with respect to doubling farmers' income, Ashok Dalwaiser always mentioned this quote. So we are losing around 93,000 crores every year because of the post-harvest losses. So just imagine that somebody has, you know, escaped from India for 10,000 crore rupees or 12,000 crore rupees. And also for just, you know, for curiosity, I would like to make you aware, what is the cost of Taj Mahal as of now? So it is around 7,000 crores. So we are losing around 93,000 crores every year because of the post-harvest losses. How many Taj Mahal can be built? I'm not influencing you people to go and build the Taj Mahal. In the pandemic year, we have to more concentrate with respect to that, building the infrastructure, medical infrastructure and all. But if you conserve those, you know, losses, how much of infrastructure, that is poor infrastructure in the villages with respect to the gold, you know, cold storage or maybe with respect to the godowns, I mean to speak. So that with respect to that, we have to control our post-harvest losses. An unfavorable condition with respect to the procurement, even in the establishment of APMC, if you go and see the reality, again, you are exploited by the middleman. To avoid the migration, you will be surprised. Every day, India is losing around 2,035 farmers. If you have any queries, you can read my article with respect to the avoiding, you know, predictive factors to avoid farming as a profession. So I was, you know, had an analysis that what are the factors that will be going to hinder the farmers to avoid farming as a profession. So thereby, with respect to that, even you just, I would like to quote an example. Your parents might be the doctor. They want you to be a doctor. Your parents might be the engineer. They want you to be an engineer. Your parents might be the teacher. They want you to be a professor. But if you are a parent as a farmer, you ask them what I want to be as your daughter or son. They say that you be something other than the agriculture. One with respect to that, it is very, you know, very, very dynamic with respect to the price factor. Another with respect to that, climate is a naturally gambling, you know, nature gambling or maybe the, you know, climate gambling, you know, profession. If the disaster happens, you have to sit whole year without any income, livelihood. And step up and adopt commercially and technically and economically viable agribusiness solution is a major aspect that we're going to promote through the contract farming. What are the types of contracts we have? So with respect to the first is a market contract. Here, what you do in the contract farming, you just agreement only to purchase the product with a predetermined price. You grow as a farmer, you grow this product. I will going to buy your product with this particular X price. For example, you have a potato. I will going to, you know, buy your product after your, you know, production. So I'll go and buy your product with the 15 rupees per kg. This is a predetermined price, nothing else. No input will be supplied in the market contract. In the partial contract, what happens? So here some of the basic requirements, some inputs will be given. And also you'll going to have the, you know, agreement with respect to that. You're going to purchase the, your, you know, produce from the farmers in a predetermined price. If you remember what are the elements that in the contract farming happens, predetermined price, quality, quantity, time, and also with respect to what product you're going to buy. So here, again, we have another total contract. Here, all the seed inputs and all the necessary input for the production will be given. And also the supervision will be made by the company. So here the farmers has to provide the labor and land and cultivate the, you know, commodity, which is demanded by the company. And all the things will be, you know, supervised and inputs, everything will be given by the farmers. So, but here the inputs are not given free of cost. Keep it in mind, the input like seeds, fertilizer, pesticide, everything is provided for the production will not be given free of cost. Some of the share, like, you know, subsidies, in the name of subsidies or in the name of something related to the concession, they may deduct some of the amounts, but some of the, you know, whatever the service they have given from the company, they will charge for their services. So now we'll understand what are the models of contract farming in India, how it is working in India. So we have three models. We'll deal one by one. One we have bipartite agreement model. So here, two people are involved. Bi means two. So as I said, try to split the word so you'll understand, you'll have the more comprehension. So instead of just mugging up and just, you know, reading the material, just try to split up the, you know, words so you'll have a better understanding. The bipartite means two people will be involved in the agreement. Those are, who are the those people? One is farmers and another is a company. So there will be agreement between the farmers and the company. So what are the agreements? One thing, the company will decide. So I will provide the, you know, inputs and services, and I will also pay for your produce. So here the farmer's role is to produce the commodity, and he has to pay for his, you know, for the input and services which are provided by the, you know, company. Okay. So it is not free of cost. That you have to keep it in mind. Majority of you will be confused with respect to that company will provide, and whatever the produce will be given to the farmers, he will get the price. No, it is not so. And tripartite. So we have discussed with respect to the farmers and company. Now we have another, you know, important institution which are involving. It is bank. In earlier cases, the farm, you know, company itself will go into provide the all the inputs and also some of the credit facility to the farmers. But in this case, the company is involving the bank in order to provide the credit. Okay, here the company will provide the inputs and services on credit. That credit is supposed to be bear by the bank in the link between the bank and, you know, in link between the company and farmers. So here the you know, you might be, you know, understood with respect to that number of real estate nowadays. It is linking in this customer, a company and bank. The three tripartite agreement will be involved in this. The same kind of pattern will be involved in the an agriculture contract farming. So that means bank is playing a role to provide the credit. Here, the company, you know, the farmer is producing and supplying to the company, but company is not directly crediting to the farmers because it has taken some of the credit from the bank for his input services and also input materials. So bank will go into, you know, credit the amount to the bank. Company will go into credit the amount to the bank, and bank will deduct the amount which is already paid to the company, and remaining amount will be credited to the farmers. So here some of the agency will be involving in the process of contracting between the farmers and company, because company is not involving any kind of extra burden with respect to the credit facility to the farmers. And now the quadpartite agreement model. Here you all understood with respect to that farmers and company, and now another two involvement will be there. The company may not be having expertise with respect to the input, or maybe it is not, you know, having access to the inputs and all. So what happens here? So they are involving one more agent, that is a input companies or a dealers, to provide the input materials to the farmers to produce some X commodity. And also they are involving state agencies or state government agencies or any government organization or cooperative organization in the contract process. So what exactly here, I would like to quote an example with respect to the Punjab. They had a Punjab Agro Food Grain Corporation. They had a Punjab Agro Food Grain Corporation, which was established in the year 2002. Sorry. Okay. So there they have come up with this agency that is governed by the government of Punjab. And they are acting as a, you know, nodal agency with respect to linking between the farmers and companies, or maybe with respect to the input dealers. So here, input dealers, they are providing the, you know, inputs to the farmers, and some farmers are directly paying the credit to the input agencies. Or here, some of the extension services which are provided by the input agencies, that is actually, you know, paid by the state agencies. And whatever the production is happening from the farmer side, it is sold to the government agencies. As I said, with respect to the Punjab Agro Food Grain Corporation, it was taking all the product. Usually, the price of the commodity is much more slightly higher than the minimum support price. And payment will be made by the agents to the farmers. Now, the state agency have number of commodity with a number of quantity. So that will be sold in throughout the India based on the its demand. So here the agency will going to act as a nodal agency, and it will going to forecast the demand in the country, and it will ask the farmers to grow certain crops in a certain area. In particularly in the Punjab, what happened, they want to break down this food system like rice and wheat. Every year they are just rotating in this. Whenever you are growing number of crops in a number of years, in the same crops in number of years, you're going to lose the soil fertility because you're extracting the same same amount and same kind of nutrients every year. So if you're not fulfilling, so obviously it will going to lose the soil quality and soil nutrients. So you may lose the productivity aspect. So they want to break down this chain, and also they want to make some of the commercial crops in the farmer's field in order to improve the farmer's income too. So now what I would mean to say here in the contract farming with respect to the farmers bill, the farmers are demanding the central and state governments to involve in the agreement, as happened in the Punjab. It was not working after 2012 because of some of the issues, political issues, or maybe some of the legal agreement issues. It is not working well in the recent days. So they are demanding that. So government has to be involved in the contract, because farmers are scared about if something goes wrong, some crisis happened or natural disaster happened, so company may take over our land. So that will not going to happen in the Farmers Act also, in the recent act. But some of the misleading, some miscommunication, or maybe with respect to the misawareness is happening in the society. So even though with respect to that, I will make you understand with respect to that, how this has to be worked in the contract farming. In a simple example, I will take you. Take any company, X company. For example, I will take an example of ITC, and they want to come up with one product that is called as any chips variety, new chips in the market. So if they go to the market for example, if you take like a 50,000 tons they require for production of certain product and build their brand. Okay, so 50,000 tons of potato they require. If they go to the mandis or market or APMC, they will not going to get the same size, same quality, and same nutritious nutrient contents product in the market. So what they do, so they will go into the, they have, as a, with respect to the, PepsiCo, you recently heard about PepsiCo has sued the, case against the four farmers regarding with respect to that, without permission, they are using, farmers are growing the, their potato crop, potato varieties or something. So here they might be have R&D team, they might be purchased some of the varieties from some company, and they will going to distribute to the farmers. And they will going to buy, because you cannot use all the kind of varieties, all the kind size of the commodity which are available in the market. So for your particular product, it will going to increase your processing cost, transport cost, and also with respect to that, it may not yield the superior quality of your product. When the quality is not good, obviously the customers will not going to accept your product. So that in that purpose, they want to have the assured supply of the food grains, one thing, and assured quality of food grains. So, and also that is supervised by their own company agents. So that means everything will be assured, and farmers also can benefit. In this angle, the contract farming will be working well in India. These are the number of examples with respect to the companies that they are working well in India. As I was mentioning with respect to the PepsiCo, ITCs, or Sukuna Chickens, or Tata Rallys, Nestle's, or maybe the HUL, these are all the companies, and Ven Chickens, okay? And these are the state-wise contract farming initiatives by the private companies. My apologies for not having the recent data, but I could not able to get the recent source, authentic source with respect to the contract farming, so that I have using this 2012 data, but it will give you a picture that how many areas, what kind of crops, and what kind of companies are involving in the involving in the contract farming. And what is the advantage of contract farming? Till now, we have discussed a number of issues. One is provision of input and production service to the farmers and access to the credit. This is the biggest advantage to the small and marginal farmers. And also introducing the appropriate technology. Farmers may not be advantaged. All the farmers may not be advantageous to have the recent technologies in their field because of lack of investment or lack of resources with him. So that means introduction of appropriate technology farmers will, that will help him to understand the skills, technical know-how, that will help him to develop his skill, and also guaranteed and fixed pricing structure. When you aware about that, I will going to get this amount of rupees for this product, you're not going to invest a lot. What is happening with respect to the Punjab and other areas? So we are using the excess of inputs. Excess of agriculture inputs like seeds, with respect to the seed rate also per area. And also I would like to mention with respect to the fertilizer application, with respect to the pesticide application. So we are over adoption of these kind of technologies. When you are using number of these kind of technologies, which is not required for the particular crop, so obviously your cost of production will going to increase. So thereby you have to make sure that what is the cost cut down in your input itself so that you can double income. When the production costing decreases, obviously whatever you get, it will be a net income. So that is a particular guarantee income in the contract farming will going to happen, and accessible to the reliable market. That means assured market for your product will be guaranteed. And what is the benefit, as I with respect to mentioned, assured market and returns will be, you're going to get risk elimination, because in agriculture, you might be seen in the recent days in the news channels that farmers are throwing their tomatoes in the roadside, and they are just throwing the watermelon in the roadside because of the lockdown, people are not going out and they are not purchasing the farmers' produce. So farmers, and the price fluctuation. One thing is that it's playing with the natural, with respect to the, gambling with the natural disaster with respect to the flood or, drought situation. And another thing is that the price fluctuation in the market, and timely transport can be done, and also reduces the exploitation from the middleman. And also with respect to the private lenders, these are the two people are getting huge benefit from the farmers. And adequate input supply can be done through the company, and it also helps to create the employment generation. And benefits to the company means uninterrupted and regular flow of raw materials to the particular company. As I said, you are dealing with a particular farmers, and you are assured that this farmers will go into provide this commodity to me. This means this is the harvest will going to do. This is the commodity. This is this much of amount of commodity I will going to get. Protection from the price fluctuation. Both for the farmers and the company will begin get benefited because they have the nominal price for win-win situation for both the companies and farmers. And long-term planning can be possible because if you want to build some of the products, some of the commodities, and you can think based on the contracting with the farmers and build the long-term commitment with the farmers and the corporate responsibilities, and also with respect to the improving the company's income, and dedicated supplier base will be there and generate the goodwill in the organization. And what is exactly the problem faced by the farmers? Both in the, I would like to combine here, problem faced by the farmers and problem faced by the sponsor. One thing that if the market price is less, the company will go and buy, the product from the market. And same thing, vice versa, I would like to mention the product, market price is more, the farmers will, break the contract from the company, and it will go to the market, and he will going to sell his produce. And also some of the social and cultural constraints are there, both with respect to the farmers and also with respect to the company. For example, if I take the X community, if you ask them to grow for the something like piggery rearing, they want to have something like piggery product, maybe the piggery related meat production, maybe they have something like ready to eat folk or something in that particular aspect. If you ask that community, they will deny on the face because their cultural and social constraints are there in the particular society. As of now, I'm just taking with respect to the example. And also with respect to the whatever the quality input dealers are giving, the input materials, it may be not superior quality, or maybe that will go into impact on the final product and that nutrient contents. Okay, so both the, you know, the breakage of contractual agreement happens from the company or maybe with the farmers also. Here the farmers are more advantageous than the company, because our laws and rules and regulations, and also that they always favor to the farmers. And what are the scopes and opportunity for the contract farming in India? So you can go with respect to the, you know, dairy farming, as with respect to high quoted Nestle's, and poultry farming that is happening with respect to Sugana chickens and all. These are the two sectors are most beneficial for the small and marginal farmers, so that they can go with respect to the integrated farming system and all. And, you know, for fruits and vegetables are the new, with respect to the vegetables, number of companies are having the agreement. But in the fruits, majorly, you know, middleman will take the part. Okay. And issues and concern, there are a number of positives and negatives are there. When you are just, you know, involving the farmers, you have the land and resources and company as it is. Development happens, and food security, because single crop or monocrop, obviously it will lead to their food insecurity in the country. We may be good at one crop or one commodity, but as India is a diversified food, you know, diversified agro climatic, condition, we are diversified food habit also, and we have to conserve our natural resources and also the biodiversity. And seed problem with respect to that, you all knew that companies will always give the hybrids, as with respect to the male sterility, or maybe with respect to that, you know, you cannot use the hybrid seeds again as a seed purpose. Again, you have to pick for the particular companies to lead all these aspects. Will going to be a crisis in the risk, you know, when you are adopting number of technologies and monocropping system happens. Labor problem, agriculture face huge problem with respect to the labor and contract disputes as with respect to that, both the, you know, companies and farmers, there are different kinds of issues out there, and middleman influence will also a different concern for the farm, you know, contract farming. And future strategies, I would like to mention, you know, if you look at something like, you know, take example of Punjab, you know, Agro Food Grain, you know, Corporation. Whenever you are involving something like government agencies, so companies will also have some ethics, and also the farmers will believe the company because some government is involving. Because if you completely hand over some of the things to the, you know, private firms, obviously they start exploiting and improve the bargaining power of the farmers. This is the only one person, one commodity. I always feel if you have something like laptop, you have the mobile phone, you are just watching this, you know, this lecture through YouTube. Who decided your mobile phone price? Who decided your laptop price? Whether you decided or the manufactured company decided. So when it comes to the, you know, farmers who produce the crop, he don't have the authority to decide the price of his own commodity. That is actually the disaster. When it comes to the, you know, marketplace with respect to the demand and supply, I agree with that. But we have to create that end kind, you know, with respect to the organizing sector in agriculture also, as it is existing in other sectors. So, and improve the bargaining power of the farmers. And don't say farmers are illiterate. They are good in the production. They know how to deal with the things. But with respect to that, they are lacking with respect to that business skills. And the selection of the appropriate plant genotype, as you know, Kalyanji was mentioning that if you want to improve the further with respect to the evergreen revolution, we have to select the appropriate plant genotype, which is going to be in a sustainable way. And minimum necessary infrastructure facility has to be created in the rural areas, and bank finance to the small and marginal farmers. This is lacking because of so much of, you know, other issues, but still we have to work on this, you know, particularly the financial assistance. And contract should be managed clear participatory manner, both the win-win situation. And another approach I would like to promote here with respect to the public-private partnership approach has to be bring here. And legalization of the tenancy, that means has to be proper, because in the land tenure system, earlier it was mentioned like that, who cultivate the land, he is the owner of the land. Now it is not so. In the land reforms, it is, you know, ownership will be protected and does not allow, you know, grow behind the certain limit, because it will go into have the disaster. Our aim is to sustainable, feed the present population and feed the, conserve the resources for the future generation. okay, and update the database of contract farming along with the relevant details. The database has to be created, which is very lacking in Indian situation. And agreement written in the vernacular language. Don't fool the farmers. Try to write the agreement in their particular local language. If you are doing the contract farming in Tamil Nadu, write it in Tamil Nadu, Tamil. Or if you are doing in Karnataka, so write it in Kannada. And agreement should be in Marathi, means Marathi language. And if you are going something related to that, Maharashtra. Okay. So that means local language has to be promoted when you are dealing with the farmers. And liability for the contractor for any environmental losses. That means the government has to bring some of the rules and regulations on the companies. So this is all about that I would like to speak, but I would like to make you clear that we are a very diversified environment. If you are travel all over India, so you will travel whole globe. That is the beauty of India. The same with respect to the diverse agroclimatic zones will provide us the better competitive production and productivity, both the things. But make sure that we have to convert our factor price advantage to the sustainable competitive advantage. Again, I would like to quote the same example with other perspective. As Kalyanji was ended, anything can wait, but not agriculture. And be, you know, whenever you get the opportunity, try to involve in agriculture and try not to waste the food, because to produce 1 kg of rice, I would like to mention again, to produce 1 kg of paddy, they require around 4,000 liters of water. 4,000 liters of water to produce 1 kg of rice. It is not just, as an easy task to grain to rice. And also with respect to that, in the lockdown, you all come to know that, which is more important. If you had an opportunity, come to our science and you can serve the country. Thank you so much for the opportunity. If you have any queries, you can ask me. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. You said it very right, that those who produce normally have control over the price, but not in agriculture. They just have to produce and then other people decide what should be the price. All the time, the city population feels that agriculture is very simple. Just plow the field, sow the seeds, wait for the rain, then there will be harvest and it will be sold in the market. But it's not all that simple, it's very complicated. And it is complicated not only economically, it is complicated geopolitically. It is equally complicated as far as the whole science is concerned. And I feel you underlined every possible fact, and I am very thankful to both of you for giving such wonderful information to us. And I definitely would like to underline your offer that please join agriculture education or agricultural science, because that can be one path of career for you. That's definitely, and this is especially for the student, the young minds, we have to keep in mind that career doesn't lie only in becoming doctor or engineer or very specific field. It has many diverse opportunities. Now there are so many questions which are posted in the group. So we have one more personality with us, Dr. Nilima Murgun. She's teacher in biology and a very experimental teacher. I would request her to take the questions, and both Dr. Vinay Kumar and Dr. Kalyan Rao Patil will answer. Thank you very much. Nilima,
the mic is muted.
Yeah. Thank you, Vijay sir, and thank you, Kalyan Rao sir and Vinay Kumar sir, for very very informative sessions. Hum aise keh sakte hain ki agriculture is our culture, with even in today's situation with around 50% of our population being engaged in agriculture. In terms of economy also, we can say our economic culture is agriculture. And we can see that this economic culture is taking a turn because of the GM or, you know, involvement of technology and marketing practices. As we understand from your lectures. Students have asked you know, very nice questions on the group. So one by one we will take the questions. Many students have asked many questions. Before going into the details of you know, questions pertaining to your sessions and technological questions, there is one simple question, Kalyan Rao sir, about technologies used in White Revolution. So just you may mention one or two, how milk production is enhanced, that a child wants to know. And then we will go to GM crops, as you had mentioned. Sir, your mic is mute. Yes.
Kindly unmute from mobile.
Hello, madam.
Yes.
With respect to the White Revolution, it is not a technology, but it is a main thing is extension activities. I can say Vinay can explain this is more better than me, because here rather than technology, the cooperative movement was led for the White Revolution. Vinay can explain better.
Okay, I would like to just take a few, you know, Varghese Kurien, you knew that he is the father of White Revolution. As with respect to that, he quoted in better way, with respect to the extension service, the transfer of technology. The cooperative means you could able to see the four hands in the cooperative movement. Okay, one thing that it's a win-win situation with respect to the producers and also the with respect to the company. So here what happens, they are involving the farmers, they are involving the marketing people, they are involving the production team, and also the company is involving here. It is like a chain linkage. So they take the product from the farmers and they process it and market it. Whatever the income they get, so that will be reversed back to the farmers. Some of the amount will be, taken as a with respect to the infrastructure development, and the remaining amount, whatever the income they get, it will be transferred back to the farmers. Why this is succeeded means assured income to the farmers. Here in the particularly, I would like to take an example with respect to the Amul than the other cooperative like KMF in Karnataka. Amul is giving the price better than the other cooperative societies. Okay, so means with respect to the fat content in the milk, based on the fat content, they are providing the price fixation will be there. One main thing with respect to that, the small farmers can be succeeded by rearing the two or three cows in his, with respect to his house. So that every day's income will going to promote to the farmers. Because in farming, what happens, this cooperative farming is not very much successful. Why means every day income will be there in the, with respect to the milk production. Every week he'll going to get the price. But when it comes to the crop, after 3 months, he'll going to get the returns. So that is what, with respect to the White Revolution, the daily income or weekly income will going to promote much higher than the cooperative farming in the agriculture sector. So, and also with respect to the White Revolution is not only, just taking the milk, it is providing the huge technological support to the farmers with respect to the hybrid breeds, with respect to the veterinary service to the farmers, everything is accessible to the farmers. It is not happening in the agriculture sectors. That's what the cooperative farming is not successful as with respect to the milk production in India.
Thank you, sir. Patil sir, students have represented layman that GM crops are condemned. Okay, because it is, people are scared that they are harmful for, humans or something like that, consumption. So can you throw some light on this?
Okay, ma'am. Before releasing any GM crop in the country, so many trials will be conducted. Just like in today's same situation is there with respect to vaccination program for this COVID-19 also. Most of the people, they are afraid at initial time, but now they are moving. Now the vaccine is not available. The same situation here also with respect to the GM crop. Before releasing the GM crop, particularly with respect to the food crop, so many tests will be conducted. That's why I in my slide also told the laboratory level study will be there and the field level trials will be conducted both for small scale level as well as a large scale level. After that, the different animal tests will be conducted with generation after generation. Is there any effect of this GM on the human, even up to this mammals also they have conducted. After conducting so many tests only, they will go into release. But this is social stigma is also there that should be removed, because in Western country the most of the people they are consuming GM food crops only. I can say even in Gujarat, ma'am, the Gujaratis are consuming cotton oils, but the 90% of the cotton grown in Gujarat is BT cotton only. But this is true. But the only thing is the different tests are conducted at different levels. Okay.
Great, sir. So now, हमें वैक्सीन लेना ही है वैसे GM crops are going to be a part of our life and they are not harmful.
I would like to add one more.
Researchers are taking care, we can say. Yes, sir.
Because you know that stigma is there. That means whatever the genetically modified crops that will alter our genetics. That was the with respect to that awareness has created the negative awareness. We called as an yellow journalism particularly. So that not will going to happen. It is the some gene extracted from other crop. So that is inserted for dealing with other like pest or maybe with respect to the diseases or maybe the drought tolerance, which are widely grown in other countries. That's what I quoted. We are exporting those commodities and we are eating, but we are not allowed to grow in our own country. So that is actually happening. I don't want to mention with respect to other issues in our country, whether it is a cultural or maybe the political issues.
Sir, I may, there was one physiology-based question over here. We may, I may continue with this, that the child had asked, what happens to the genetic material and genes that we consume as food? So here comes the answer of this question, maybe what, GM crops, whether they are harmful or whatever. So the child should know, and it is a very good question, I should say, ke man mein ye vichar to aaya. So the child must be a 9th standard student probably, and in 10th standard you are going to study physiology of digestion, where you will come to know about various enzymes that are going to digest various components of your food, and you will get the answer of what happens to the genes that we consume as our food. So good question. And sir's question, the other question, whether the genetically engineered food is going to affect us. Both are answered in this question, I suppose. Sir, Patil sir, see, nowadays we have, understood the importance of protecting our wild varieties also. Like Rahi Bai Popere, who won Padma Shri for, her seed bank, and we have gene banks. Maharashtra state also has gene banks. So the children, they want to know that wild varieties are also, or indigenous varieties are also, have shown to be productive and they don't require much of the inputs. At the same time, genetically modified crops are expensive. The seeds are expensive or they need a lot of input. So what is the balance? How to strike balance between the two?
Okay, ma'am, very interesting question has asked. Hello, Sadhana. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay. With respect to the wild varieties or wild genotypes, in India, we have a very long history of the wild genotypes. And even under, there is a separate act is passed in 2001, Protection of Plant Varieties and Farmers' Right Act, 2001. Under this act, whatever the farmer's variety, we will call most of the indigenous varieties are protected by the farmers, as you told, Padma Shri from Maharashtra. all these varieties which are protected under the PPVFR means if you have any wild genotypes that can be protected under the PPVFR, and you will get that royalty also after protecting. And another thing very interesting here is the most of the wild genotypes, they are low yielder compared to our hybrids, whatever the hybrids release. Thing here is that the wild relatives are very much important because that can be served as a transfer of the any disease or pest resistant purpose, because the most of the wild species, they are highly resistant or they have a very unique character in them. Such type of variety can be useful for breeding the new varieties, particularly for the pest and diseases. With respect to the GM crop, most of the genetically modified crops, the genes is transferred into the high yielding varieties. Already varieties and hybrids are developed. For such varieties and hybrids, we are transferring that genes to the cultivated already existing species. By that way, we can only just modify that variety. These varieties are called as essentially derived varieties. Already varieties are there. We are only modifying certain characters of that variety. That's right. Means GM technology is always we are using in high yielding variety, but this wild genotypes and wild relatives are very much important with respect to using those as a source for transferring any particular disease resistant, pest resistance purpose.
Your mic is
muted.
So now I think the query is solved, whatever the children had. Okay, we have not approved brinjal and this in India, but sir has answered this question, I believe. There are questions about wages, like, you know, gender bias in daily wages in farming. So is it so even now? This is what is the question, whether the male and the female agro wo jo mazdoor hai unhe paisa alag alag milta hai abhi bhi, aur aisa hai to kyun hai, aur kyun ladies ko kam milna chahiye. This kind of question also students have asked, and I felt like asking it just now. Though it is not dealing with contract farming, this shows the awareness what they have, social awareness. That's why.
Whether Kalyanji will answer or whether I should answer?
Anybody. Okay. Because both so, of you, you know the situation, what is happening actually now. We don't know about it.
Okay. So with respect to that, agriculture demands the laborious task. With respect to the machineries, whatever you handle, it's not female friendly, or maybe the women friendly technologies are not there. If you take an example of tractor, that can be not be driven by the women. Maybe some of the examples are there in the Northeast, I would like to mention, but not as in the usual cases. But whenever it comes to the disparities are there in the way back to the, you know, pre-independence to the post-independence, but this disparity has to go. That's what in MG Nareka and all, they have made the you know, equal wage system for the men and women. I would like to quote here, but government is pushing, but when it comes to the local you know, farmers, they have the disparity, means women cannot do certain of the task in the agriculture activities. So that's what, you know, male is getting the better than the female. But when it comes to the Northeast, you may not find that kind of disparity in India itself, Northeast particularly. That is women dominated, you know, areas. So the woman is getting the better wages also there. When it comes to the agriculture, obviously I agree that 70% of the, you know, task is done by the women. When it comes to the total number of working days for the women is higher. When it comes to the men, it's lower. And with respect to the wage rate is there, it is a social stigma, but mainly it is depends on the what kind of quantity of work the men and women is doing. Based on that, it will be decided. Okay, when it comes to the forest, particularly in the coffee estate and all, tea estate and all, women is getting the better price than the men, and she is also doing the better productivity over there. When it comes to the weeding and all, men is not getting the wages over there also. I mean, with respect to that number of employment in the weeding activities, transplantation and all, so women is dealing very high. So some, I agree with you as a student, you have asked a very good question with respect to the gender bias, you know, bias, or maybe with respect to the wage disparity. But when you go with the quantity of work and that demands with respect to the higher wages, even in the construction work, you can observe women is getting the less price, less wages. And this is what I would like to quote as an example.
Great. Sir, about contract farming, there are one or two questions I would like to ask. One is, what happens to excess produce? If there is excess produced, mm-hmm. you know, apart from contract, who gets the benefit?
So in some, you know, it is not in the case with respect to the contract farming. He will be decided with this much of quantity I required. That is based on the, you know, whatever the variety he has given. He has the prediction that, okay, this much of production will going to happen. I will going to buy this much of product. He has the company has the prediction that they require this much of amount. Even in a slight higher production, the company will not going to deny. But in the overproduction, it is not going to happen. Because of the, they are giving the technology and this much of the quantity of the produce will going to happen in particular land and definitely they will going to get. So this situation happens when there is a price clash in the market. When there is a price clash in the market, so company will go and buy in the mandis or somewhere because farmers will be disadvantaged. At that time, farmers can directly go to the court and issue the legal things, and he will get the compensation because our Indian policies are farmers friendly policies, and it is not vice versa. If the company farmers sell his produce to the market with a higher price, so if the company will not go because they knew that it will not go into work in the legal issues also. That's the same things happen in the PepsiCo's farmers issues also. And we all knew that it's a farmer's serving country or a rural country. So we always favor to the farmers and farmers' development. And usually these things will not going to happen, the excess production and all.
Okay, so same thing applies to due to calamities and all if there is loss.
Okay, exactly. The calamities, that risk share will be there with the companies only. The people have that stigma in the mind. If something goes wrong, like natural disaster or flood, so we have to bear all the cost of the production to the company. No, it is not so. Company is also equally responsible. That's what now the farmers are demanding. Involve some government agencies in between the contract between the farmers and also the company, not direct. So there will be over exploitation, as you said, with respect to that genetical resources and all. So this is happens. So we have to conserve and involve some of the authentic agency because government is working with respect to no profit, no loss basis. But private companies is not in the soap. So they are in the profit oriented. Obviously, they start exploiting the natural resources. Yes, yes, ma'am.
Last two questions. Maybe I will take. One is the child wants to know about open source farming. Is it better than the contract farming where the farmer is free to decide the crop? And
yes, if he is so advanced with the technologies and if he is well educated with respect to the price forecasting, I'm not mean to say with respect to that cultivation price forecasting, and he's having the better market facilities, then he can be advantageous. But small and marginal farmers, 88% of the farmers are small and marginal farmers. Yes. I mean, so they are resource poor farmers. They are not having enough credit to introduce the technologies or buy these all kind of inputs with their own. So they have to depend on the money lenders. So they have to these 5% people are there. They're resource rich farmers. They are doing this open farming than the contract farming. Those who are not doing the contract farming, they are depending on the APMCs or local vendors. So obviously, they are not advantageous. If you are resource rich and you have a better market facilities, the open market is always, open farming is always better than the contract farming. But you want to secure yourself with the minimum minimum returns, then the contract farming is better. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. I think last question both of you may address to. It is like when you go for contract farming, like PepsiCo is having contract with particular farmer or something like that. it will be for, you know, maybe for years to come or something like that, maybe for 2 years, 3 years, whatever. So will it not lead to continuation of same crop and degradation of land and, you know, allied farming problems? And what is the solution? This is one thing. And secondly, which is the best way? You four types of contracts you explained. So which is the best?
So the first I would like to answer the last, you know, second question, which is the best model. As I said, with respect to the quadpartite model is the best because you're involving the government agencies. So obviously it will look at both the aspect. One is farmers, you know, security, and another is the natural resource security. Both the things will be covered in the quadpartite model. So that, you know, that is always beneficial. That's what, you know, farmer is also proposing to the government in the new amendment acts. And second, with respect to that monocropping, obviously it will going to be a, you know, negative impact on the natural resource with respect to that. But here, as a conscious, we have to be a, you know, efficient utilization of available resources. That's what, you know, sustainability will speak. Okay, not over exploitation. And company will also target for the higher utilize of the fertilizers, pesticides and all. Meanwhile, they also look at these are the pesticide residue issues are more concerned in the recent days. So they will not going to provide that kind of extensive, high dosage of, you know, pesticides and all, because crop have the pesticide residue that will directly impact on your health as in human health. Not genetically modified crops, but these pesticide residue will have a direct impact on the health. So company will also take care of this because they have invested crores, so they don't want to lose the brand because of a higher, you know, higher in a dosage of pesticide and insecticide. And monocropping, obviously the farmers has to be aware, not going same crop throughout the year or number of years. So it will, you know, it will not be a, you know, best practice for you as a farmer. So integrated, or maybe the rotation basis or multi-cropping system in a year is always best. And also integrated nutrient management, if you do, it's good. Because you just see that every day we are having morning same kind of food, afternoon chapati and night chapati. But it is a something, some in between we are managing our nutrients to balance our process. So the same thing we have to deal with the soil also. Okay. Every day if you have same kind of meals, no change, it directly impacts on your health. The same way the crop.
Great. So the last question, it is like people say nowadays, you know, in urban areas, microgreens and all those things are coming up, and people say that you should not, you know, you should go for specialized, particularly packed for microgreen grains, and otherwise you will be consuming pesticides through those microgreen, you know, the seeds. So what do you think, Kalyan Rao sir, is it so that whatever available in the market, whatever, you know, I'm buying from my grocer, is it dangerous for me or is it okay?
Mike, sir. No, it is not audible.
Sir, you are not mic- audible.
Mic off hai aapka. Mobile mein. No, it is not audible.
Sir, we can't hear you.
Okay, I'll just take an example because in earlier days, if you're using, you know, paste every day, we are not knowing that whether it is a chemical one or organic one, or partially they are involving the chemicals. Now we are just observing at the bottom. When, if it is a green, it is a something like organic. If it is a blue, it is a, you know, not something related to the danger. And red, it is there. So obviously, it is a very, you know, heavy chemicals they are used in the paste. Every day you're using. That's what, you know, some companies, ex companies are branding that every day you are consuming the chemical in the process of cleaning your tooth. So they have built the brand and now it is a good brand in the market. So I would like to say here, same thing, whenever you are going to the groceries, you are not knowing, because in Indian, it is unorganized sectors. We are not knowing that where this crop is grown and how it is grown. But when it comes to the developed countries, you are knowing that where this crop is grown and whether it is something like, you know, in the label itself, in the barcode itself, you'll come to know that whether it is having any kind of adverse effect. So in India, it is very tough to absorb. Whether you are consuming the chemicals or just a food, or maybe, you know, so that's what this kind of, you know, new business models are evolving, you know, hydroponics and terrace gardening, these are evolving. It's always better to grow your own food, but make sure that if you are having the resources, you'll be healthy and you'll enjoy as a kindergarten or maybe something, as nowadays age-old gardens also coming. So they enjoy with the environment. But in India, with respect to the other USA and China, whatever the chemicals they are using, we are not using that extent. So still safer, but some of the extent, we are still in the alarming mode. We should be in a sustainable, both with respect to the health hazards. So, good example, I would like to quote the daily oil you are consuming. For example, I would like to quote if your sunflower oil, very, very, you know, unwagyu examples I would like to quote. So 1 kg of sunflower is around 80 rupees if you make. So to produce like, you know, 1 liter of, sunflower oil, you may require 3 to 4 kg of sunflower. So that means 80 into 4, around 320 rupees. So what is the cost of your oil? It's 150 rupees. What is exactly, additives are there? You just imagine, and likewise, you have to consume your food. So you should be educated in that way. So,
correct. So, great, Patil sir and Vinay Kumar sir. May go on discussing this because we can see there are several issues and there is so much to learn from you. So we may have additional sessions later. Over to Ajay sir. I really am thankful to you and I learned so many things from you in this session. Thank you so much. Thank you. Over to Ajay sir.
Thank you, sir. I think that these 2 hours were great in nutrition and were pesticide free. I felt like saying that, because it was so much enriching. And I must thank Dr. Vinay Kumarji, Dr. Kalyan Patil sir, and also Dr. Nilima Mulgun for interacting with them. I must thank all participants who asked very relevant questions. I also should thank our Kumarji, who makes all the necessary technical arrangement for making all these things possible. So, dhanyavaad sir, milenge phir, and students ke liye especially, ye lecture series chalte rahega aur judte rahiye. Dhanyavaad. Good day to you.
Thank you.